So we're talking about Sensible City Lab and what we do there. So we are there at MIT, so you're welcome to visit us anytime that you're in Boston. And now we are opening again. And the Sensible City Lab, it's a multidisciplinary lab. So we have here in this representation all the people that work at the lab. So we have computer scientists, mathematicians, but also sociologists, urban planners, designers, and all of them working together in multiple projects. And what's interesting about the lab is that sometimes we have a single project with this multidisciplinary team, but also we have people working in multiple projects simultaneously. And this gives a pretty unique perspective about urban problems. Sometimes when we go to, and all of you who works for cities or with cities, you know that it's quite common that people working from the transportation department does not speak with the planning department and not with the waste collection department. And we know that all these things, when we live in the cities, they are integrated. So what we try to do at the lab is to make this also part of the research. And why we're focusing on cities? Because as we know, we have cities covering only 3% of the Earth crust. However, we have more than 50% of the population of the world living in cities. And we are responsible for 70% of energy consumption and 75% of CO2-related emissions. So if we want to solve any problem at the urban, at the global scale, we need to focus on cities. And at the lab, for almost 20 years now, when Carlo Ratti started the lab, between 2004 and 2006 is debatable, the date, but basically, at that point, it was already, okay, look, there is this physical and social layer of the city, but also more and more, and this was almost 20 years ago, more and more, we have this digital layer of our lives that are actually embedded in our social and physical city. So how we can bridge the gap, but also how we can create new things within these two layers of the city. So this is what the Sensible City Lab tries to do. And the lab, so basically how the lab works. So we work with cities and with private companies across the globe. And this map only shows the cities with which we have worked directly, meaning that the city, they have sponsored one particular project, and we have worked with the cities for 3 years. This is not where the projects have happened only, but only the cities have partnered with the lab. And currently, we are in Boston, and we have three other labs, one in Singapore that has been working for 10 years, and we have one in Amsterdam. I will show a project. We had a project with them for 6 years, and now we create the Sensible Amsterdam Lab. And tomorrow I'm flying to Stockholm, where we have the Sensible Stockholm Lab. So now, the most interesting part, I will show you four projects. And I will start with one that is very related to what Sue showed before. It's about pedestrian mobility. And we had, and I'll show you two projects within a family that we call Desirable Streets. And how did we start this project? It was with the following. So we have data from a very, at that point, it was the most used pedestrian app in the United States. They have been sold. And they provided us anonymized data for pedestrian movements in San Francisco, to show one project, and in Boston. Okay. When we start mapping all pedestrians' movement in both cities, we saw that approximately 20% of the path, they were not the shortest path. And then we started asking, so why people are not taking the shortest path? And we have two questions. The first project, Pointless Path, is the question was the following. Is there anything in our brain that makes us navigate urban space in a very particular way, meaning that regardless of our interests, only by navigating the physical environment of a city do we navigate cities in a very specific and human-only way? And let me tell you one anecdote. So Sue showed her path going from her house to Harvard. And then what we start perceiving is that even when people have only one origin and one destination, the path from the origin to the destination was not necessarily the same as the path from the destination to the orange. If we think of your own, if you walk, if you don't drive to work, as you shouldn't, you should walk. So if you walk to work, think if you take exactly the same path going to work and returning home. And what we found is that, interestingly, if we think of the shortest path logic, obviously, the shortest path is the same. However, we start seeing in these thousands and thousands of paths in the city that people were not taking this, not only not taking the shortest path, but also they were not taking the same path going to a destination and returning from the destination. So we started thinking, but what people take into consideration to make these choices? And what we did is a very short video explaining how we define the pointest path, and we explained after what exactly is the shortest, the pointest path. So, we, as you can see here, first, let's play the music. Can be louder, perhaps. So what we noted first here is that people, those not taking the shortest path, what they would take in consideration. So if I can see in my line of sight, if I have my destination, I will try in any intersection, I will try to minimize the angle. So if my destination is there and my shortest path, even if my shortest path is turning 90 degrees and then another 90 degrees, if I have shortest angle, smaller angle, I would tend to take the smaller angle. So for us, this was a pretty interesting problem. It was published in a journal, very computer science, is Nature Computational Science. But something that for us, I'm an urban planner. So the paper was nice, the mathematics behind is super interesting. However, there is a problem here. When people navigate space, are they only considering the geometry of the city? We, as urban planners, say, no, it's not possible. They might be taking other things into consideration, right? So the second project of this line of research, overall we call desirable street, is, okay, are there any urban features attracting people to some street segments? So let me explain. We had 20% of people not taking the shortest path. So we start mapping only those paths. And then we start seeing, within this 20% of people not taking the shortest path, are there some street segments that are more often taken by people? So they are already far from their shortest path. They shouldn't be there. They are not making their journey more efficient. And on top of that, some street segments are attracting more deviants of the city. So it's okay, are there anything there explaining why these street segments are more desired than others? So we start asking, are people avoiding busy roads? Are people trying to visit more shops or accessing green spaces? And what we did with that, we mapped all amenities in the city, and also another thing that we did, and here we can see pretty clearly which is the shortest path and which is the desirable path. So the purple one is the desirable, and the black one is the shortest. And obviously, you can see more or less, yeah, it's true. The desirable path, it has more greenery, it has more windows, more open into the streets, whereas the black one, the shortest path, they are more arid. But what we're doing here is that we're not only mapping where the shops are or the trees are, etc., but using computer vision, we were quantifying everything. We were quantifying the number of openings in the street, so we have a window or doors. We are quantifying the amount of greenery. We are quantifying the number of cars parked in the streets. So with all this data, we could determine what exactly attract people to each street segment. So then we have this series of maps. And why this project was important? When we published this project, we thought, okay, perhaps if somebody will contact us, it will be some scholars doing work on mobility or walkability index, etc. But no. What was interesting is that the first emails that we started to receive, they were from businesses trying to say, okay, look, now you have proven what attracts more people to some street segments. Can you sell this technology? I say, no, you cannot. I cannot sell this technology because we just published it. You can simply run the math and you do it for yourself. So we don't sell anything. But what was interesting is that we not only say, yeah, obviously, if we have some restaurants, people will try to deviate from the shortest path to go through a street where we have some restaurants, right? Right. However, what we start to show is that there is a saturation for each component that attracts more people. There is a saturation point, meaning that if we have only one restaurant, if you have zero restaurant and one restaurant, the restaurant will attract some pedestrians. If you have three, they will attract much more than three times the deviants. But if you have eight, then it doesn't matter if you have eight or 16 or 20, it's over. You reach a saturation point. So this, for those who are either opening businesses in the city or for city planners doing zoning, it's a pretty important piece of information about pedestrian movement in cities. But then we have another part of our project, which is the following. We decide to analyze also not only how pedestrians move in the cities, but also how people move in cities with cars. And this is a pretty important problem for us, because if you go to some cities like New York, we have too many cars, as in many other cities, right? But I have before that, I need to tell a story that I think is super cool. It's the following. In early 20th century, they have the first urban planning congress in the world. It was in Washington, D.C. Okay. And then they have one problem for this congress, and the problem was horses. There were too many horses on the streets. They were not only causing traffic, they were, but most importantly, they were pooing in the streets. So we have excrement, horse excrement, everywhere. To the point that they say, look, if we don't clean excrements in the city, in Chicago, in 10 years, the excrements of horses will reach the fourth floor of Chicago. It was a problem. But they also had another problem, and the other problem is the following. Horses, they die, as all of us, right? The problem is that if somebody has one horse, the person did not have enough money to have two horses. So if they were using a horse and the poor horse died, the guy, usually it was a man, the guy did not have any money to bring another horse to remove the carcass. So the problem was less traffic, too many cars, they were, but it was okay. There were excrements everywhere, and there were carcasses everywhere. So this urban planning, Anthony would like this story, because this urban planning congress, it was supposed to last 10 days. After 2 days, they canceled the conference, because, okay, look, there is no solution for that. Let's go home, because we are losing our time here. So they simply canceled the congress after 2 days. Okay, 20 years later, the solution was there. Everything was solved. What was the solution? Cars. So at some point, there are two lessons here. At some point, the enemy, today's enemy, might have been your friend a few years ago. So the car was the solution. But the most important thing that I learned from this story is that oftentimes the solution for our problems don't belong to our realm. So perhaps all of us here talking about, that's why I think this smart cities realm is interesting, because now finally we urban planners, we need to deal and talk with mathematicians, with sociologists, with computer scientists in a daily basis. And why? Because oftentimes the solution for our problems don't show up in our domain. And this was what happened with the cars, with the horses and the cars. But okay, moving 80 years later, the same situation happens with cars. And in this case, in New York, we have too many cars. And then we said, okay, but let's see how we can understand and try to find some solutions for this problem, right? And what happened with New York is that a mayor at the time, it was Michael Bloomberg, and he used to have in his office a saying. As you know, the dollar bill has a phrase, which quite it's called, "In God we trust." And then he had a say in his office, "In God we trust. Everybody else, bring me data." So this is the principle that every city should use, right? If you don't have data, don't talk to me. Go home and produce some data. And then Bloomberg said, okay, so if we have so much data, let's put it open. So in New York, they had more than 150 million taxi trips per year. And they released everything. And what we start seeing, lots of people simply mapping taxi movements in the city. Hey, it was fine, it's a beautiful map, etc. But okay, what's the question there, right? One thing is to represent reality as accurate as possible. The other thing is to find solutions. Ah, and I'll tell you another story before entering this project. I will make a comparison, because since I will not be here tomorrow, and I was talking to Sue, okay, perhaps people will put some questions. And one question that usually they bring to this type of conference, so I will put to myself and they will answer the question, is about, what about digital twins, right? Data, smart cities, and digital twins. Okay, I'll tell you a story. There is an Argentinian writer called Jorge Luis Borges. And this guy wrote a short story about the land of the cartographers. And the land of the cartographers is the following. So they have a map of the city the size of this lectern. But the map was not accurate enough. So they decided to make a map of the city the size of this screen. Not accurate enough. They made a map of the side of this room. Not accurate enough. To the point that they made a map of the city the size of the city. And then they start to live on the map, and all the city starts to ruin underneath it. So they forgot about the city, and they were just living in this representation of the city. On the other hand, so this is, let's say that if this is digital twin, on the other hand, I have another, a very simple equation. It has three letters. E equals M times C squared. This equation, it leaves so much outside it, but so much, so much, so much. However, this very simple equation explains most part of the world, right? So sometimes having so much data as the cartographers had does not solve your problem. It simply represents your problem better. Sometimes the solution is very simple, but more powerful. So, finishing the metaphor, let's go what we did here. We decided, okay, if we have 150 million trips in New York, what we can learn? We had two projects. One of them, that I'm not showing today, we decided to measure how many of these trips could be shared. And this was before Uber Pool. And why this is important? Because when we published the idea of, okay, look, in the city of New York, more than 40% of the trips could be shared if the trips are leaving Manhattan. Uber calls us, and they become a sponsor of the lab. But in this project, we have another question, and the question came because of the following. When we published the paper saying, okay, yes, in New York, 40% of the taxi trips could be shared, some guy, I agree with him, some guy in New York Times said, okay, these guys from MIT, they decided to prove that 40% of the trips in Manhattan could be shared. But they forgot to talk to anyone in the city. And New Yorkers will never share a car with anybody. Obviously, Uber Pool came to disprove the journalist's affirmation. But we were kind of, we felt in our heart, oh my God, now New York Times doesn't like us. So let's see what we can do. So we said, okay, what if we try to prove that we can reduce the number of taxis in New York without asking anybody to share any trip? And what was the situation? The situation was the following. So let's imagine that I come here, and I'm a taxi driver, and I drop Benedict off. And now, what should I do? I have two options, basically. I stay here without doing anything until a passenger comes, or I start driving around. By chance, somebody can come up, and I take this person. But we thought, okay, look, but if the city of New York has so many taxi trips, there must be a pattern, right? So what we found, okay, look, I'm here, and I dropped Benedict off. Somebody else dropped Anthony off there. And there is a possibility that in 5 minutes, one passenger, Sue, will request a taxi there. And there is another possibility that within the same 5 minutes, Valeria will request a taxi there. If neither Anthony or I know where other passengers will be, we start driving. I might be driving that direction, and Anthony also, and he will arrive before me. And he will take Valeria's ride, and I will lose the trip. And I will start driving more and more, polluting more and more, etc. If I knew that, okay, oh, in 5 minutes, Valeria will request a taxi, and Sue will request a taxi, the system would say, Anthony goes there, Fabio goes there. And in this case, we'll save lots of trips, right? So we decided to do, basically, this is the idea. And we also know, because we had the information of every taxi in New York, that 50% is astonishing, but it's true. 50% of the time, taxis in New York, they are driving empty. So we decided, what if we could make a network with all the taxi trips, with all the drop-offs, with all the next requests within 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and see if I send all the taxis to all possibilities, who should be the driver picking up which passenger? So this is what we did. It has sound as well. If you can put the sound on. Ah, the sound's so nice. Can you put the sound on, please? Is it there? So basically, it should be something. But these are all the trips in New York. And as I mentioned, we made this network linking all the possible drivers and passengers. And then we start seeing how many trips we could save if I could have a centralized system sending the driver to the right spot. And as you can see, we could save lots of trips by only organizing the system. So without asking anybody to share any trip and without asking passengers to walk anything. So this is one example of data analysis that can benefit a lot cities, not only in terms of mobility, but also in terms of emissions, and also in terms of savings, because then if we reduce the overall traffic in the cities, obviously you're going to have a better flow in the city with all the economic benefits of that, right? However, and this paper was pretty nice for us because it was not only published in Nature, but it was also the cover of the magazine. Nature is probably most of you know, but is one of the most important general science magazines. And in this case, having the cover is not only important for us as a lab, but also I think Nature is usually the journal that publishes about the health of whales in Antarctica, right? And if Nature decides to put on its cover a urban problem, it emphasizes that regardless your area of expertise, urban problems needs to be at the forefront. But then I showed you some projects that we're dealing with data. But at some point, the lab also builds stuff. We build sensors, we deploy sensors, in the sewage, in trash trucks, in electronics, everything, we deploy sensors. And in this case, we had a challenge. The city of Amsterdam came to us and said, look, Amsterdam, as many cities around the world are investing heavily in autonomous mobility. They are either trying to attract companies, or they are changing their regulations and even creating special roads only for autonomous cars. We all know that, right? So when Amsterdam came to Sensible City Lab, they said, "Hey, look, we want to do the same thing." And then we said, "Okay, look, but Amsterdam, you have 100 kilometers of canals. And by the way, this is only half of what the city used to have early 20th century. Amsterdam paved almost 50% of its canals to make space for roads." Our rationale was the following: why don't we bring back to this infrastructure actual uses for the city? Why don't we create, rather than autonomous vehicles, why don't we create autonomous boats? So with Wageningen and Delft, we create an institute called AMS Institute. And we start to develop autonomous boats for the city. It was five years ago, a little bit more now. And the first challenge was this. This is a summer day in Amsterdam. So when people say, oh, navigating canals is easier than navigating roads, look, it's not. And what we have here is actual boat traffic in Amsterdam. So we had to map, we had two basically rationales. One of them is called global path planning. So if I want to leave from any point to go to any destination in different times of the day, knowing all the traffic, I can dispatch my boats in a more efficient way, right? But then also, we said, okay, this is cool, but how can we come from this data analysis to the actual boat? And we had another challenge. Another challenge was the following. We divide the city of Amsterdam in a grid, 500 by 500 meter grid, and we compare if you leave any cell going to any other cell in the city of Amsterdam, would you go fast by boat, by car, by public transportation, walking or bicycle. Bicycle in Amsterdam, as expected, beats basically all other modes, which is very good. And also, so the, we knew that, okay, yeah, it's nice to bring boats back to Amsterdam, in not for tourists, but a real boat. But also what we realized is that we should not build boats to compete with other modes, like bicycles. It's better to have bicycles navigating Amsterdam. But so we decided to, we did a lot of technical work, so I'm not having the slides here, but if you go on website, you're gonna see, we have been testing small boats, like it was 1 meter by 50 centimeters. It looked like a baby bath tube. And then people were joking, oh, this is a toy, etc. And we've been testing the swimming pool a lot. But then we started doing, we need to do some renderings to show to Amsterdammers, look, it might be great, etc. And some solutions, design solutions. But eventually, in October 2021, it was our deadline to have one boat. And this is what we have. This needs to be sound, guys. Because even the accent is important here. Yes.
This is Lucy. Lucy is a rowboat, a fully autonomous, zero-emission boat that operates on urban waterways. And she can change the way cities work. As congestion and emissions continue to rise, while cities continue to grow, the existing infrastructure of many cities struggles to keep up. Rowboats offer a solution by moving road traffic to the water. By bringing passengers from A to B, or as an on-demand boat, taking you anywhere you want. And they can also help the city as a multi-purpose workboat. Take Crystal. She is equipped to collect household waste to free the streets from heavy garbage trucks. Rowboats are fully autonomous, so they navigate without a skipper and can operate 24/7. In order to sail by themselves, rowboats need to perceive their environment and recognize objects such as bridge pillars, floating objects, and of course, other vessels. The primary source of information comes from a LiDAR sensor, but rowboats are also equipped with cameras, GPS, and a digital compass. Rowboat's onboard computer combines and processes all of the data and runs the rowboat software so it can successfully complete its mission plan. After 5 years of development, testing and experimentation, we have now successfully enabled autonomy on the full-scale prototypes. Rowboat is ready for the next step. Join us and let's unlock the potential of urban waterways together.
So next time that you visit Amsterdam, you are invited to go to AMS, and you have the two boats there. We have one boat for passengers, but the most important is the boat for waste removal. And why this is important? Because we knew that we had to have a boat to transport people because journalists, they need to go on board, right? Otherwise, they don't believe that the boat exists. So we built a boat for journalists. But for the city itself, what's more important is the trash collection. And why? Amsterdam, as you know, is a historic city. And everywhere in the city, they have underground bins, except in the city center. And why? Because they cannot excavate there, not only for historical reasons, but also because if they dig there, they have all the wooden structure of the canal walls, and they might collapse. So bringing trash collection back to the canals using autonomy, it's a way of trying to relieve the city from all the heavy traffic that they have currently with trucks. So this is one of another example that what the lab does, from collecting data, analyzing data, but also proposing new solutions for cities. And I hope you have enjoyed, and I'm happy to answer any question if you have any. Thank you very much. Thank you.